Hi, everyone. I'm Monsignor Jim Vlaughan. Welcome to Good News. Here's Karen Danka-Smith, my co-host.
Hello, everyone, and hello, Monsignor.
How are you? Okay.
Great. How are you doing?
You know where I was recently? The National Shrine.
In Washington,
yeah.
D.C.
So were you there a lot when
the
you were a student down there?
The National Shrine of the Immaculate Conception.
Yeah, you know it
was
well.
On my campus. I went to Catholic University. And we know we would go to Mass in the chapel usually with the,
sure.
with
the,
our friends, fellow students, a little more intimate. But for big events, we would go to the cathedral. And, oh, God.
It's amazing, right?
Gorgeous. Absolutely gorgeous.
You know, it's so big. There's actually, it's got its own post office in the basement.
Yeah.
And a snack bar.
That's right.
I never heard of a basilica
That's
with a snack
right.
bar. I'm not even saying Peter's has that.
Isn't that funny?
It's
and we went back. I brought my children and my husband there to Catholic University to see my campus. For the first time, none of them had been there.
Oh, wow.
And we went to the cathedral. And they were absolutely blown away. And it was cool to see it through their eyes.
Yeah, sure.
How impressive the
it's so
it really
huge
is.
And giant. Well, we're talking about great cathedrals today.
Oh, very good.
And we
good.
Have two great cathedrals we're focusing on. One is the one in Manhattan. You might have heard of it, St. Patrick's Cathedral.
Yeah, right.
Just went through a gigantic renovation,
That's
and there's
right.
a new book out about it, which is going to be, this book is beautiful. And
yeah.
The cathedral, I don't know if you've been there yet, but it's absolutely gorgeous. You were there just recently
That's
with your
St.
family,
Pat's.
Right?
Yeah, you know, I felt like being in the city a lot, you feel like that cathedral was under construction, renovation forever.
Yeah.
But wow,
it's
what,
so
was it worth it?
You know,
it
it's amazing,
gorgeous.
Like the stained glass windows, they were saying in some cases they had to take 3 inches of soot off them.
No
so
way, really?
When they took it off, I mean, the amount of brightness
it's
is just incredible.
Beautiful.
So that's
breathtaking.
Beautiful. Then
yes.
we also have St. Agnes Cathedral,
oh.
our own cathedral here in the Diocese of Rockville Center on Long Island,
right.
has been renovated and just rededicated and the
yeah.
new altar consecrated. And
that's so great.
That place is absolutely gorgeous. You probably see it in our daily Mass. And you might want to know a little bit more about it and say, well, you know, from where did it come and what is this
that's
renovation
right.
about and what are the little intricacies? Both of these cathedrals have great intricacies
oh, and great, great
worth
stories.
Knowing. Yeah.
Definitely.
So it's going to be fun. It's going to
I
be
think that's really cool about our church, too, that you can have the simplest, quietest, humblest little church that you can celebrate Mass in up to these beautiful, gorgeous
cathedrals right?
that glorify
yeah.
God. Yeah.
I remember the first time I celebrated Mass at St. Patrick's Cathedral,
Ooh.
And I was walking out and I said, you know, for all intents and purposes, this is like playing the garden.
That's
you know,
right.
this is a big
yeah.
deal. Celebrating Mass St. Patrick's Cathedral. I mean, the Mass is the Mass is the Mass. But celebrating at St. Patrick's is really
oh, it's
quite.
Beautiful.
And also St. Peter's. Bishop Murphy arranged one time for me to celebrate Mass at St. Peter's.
You did.
And that was very humbling.
Wow.
Yeah, I had like a lump in my throat. It was really
oh,
a
wow.
beautiful moment. So
very
it's
special.
About cathedrals, the power cool. of the church, places where we worship today.
Oh, that's great.
It's going to be fun.
Excited.
Let's get it. Since 1879, St. Patrick's Cathedral has provided the faithful of New York and the world a place to find God amidst the hustle and bustle of Manhattan. A beautiful new coffee table book entitled St. Patrick's Cathedral, The Legacy of America's Parish Church, explores the cathedral's narrative as told by Timothy Cardinal Dolan, Bishop Robert Barron, Dr. Henry Kissinger, Stephen Colbert, and many others. The book is even filled with keepsake items, such as a ticket reproduction for special cathedral events, a Christmas music program from 1895, and historic postcards, too. Here to share the rich history of St. Patrick's Cathedral is Kate Monahan, Assistant Communications Director for the Archdiocese of New York and editor of this great book. Thanks for being with
yes,
us.
Welcome. It's
me.
A beautiful book.
Isn't it great?
Yeah.
We were up, you know, because we do the television program with Cardinal Dolan,
mm-hmm.
and I just happened to be in your office
yeah.
and landed a copy of this, and when I got home,
oh,
I said, this is incredible.
Awesome.
What an interesting idea. How did it come about?
Well, it was actually Cardinal Dolan's idea. We were about a year into the restoration, and he said, I really want to have a book commemorating the restoration of the
wow.
cathedral.
Yeah.
And asked me to come up with an idea because I was handling the public relations for the restoration campaign. And so I was happy to do that, and I went back and forth a little bit and said, you know, I had read a lot of the books on St. Patrick's, mm-hmm. and they're great books, but they're maybe a little drier. And I thought, wouldn't it be cool if you had the perspective of people who are attending masses and liturgies all the way from maybe more high-profile people to people who got married there.
Oh,
and
sure.
He loved the idea, fortunately, and so here we are.
What a daunting task,
yeah.
though. It sounds like, did this take you a really long time to put it all together the way you did?
It did. It did take a lot of time. I was fortunate to work with the archives of the Archdiocese of New York, Father Michael Morris and his staff, another Kate, and they were wonderful. They were very helpful with all those pullouts
yeah.
and all the pictures. And then I was fortunate to work with a lot of other photographers who were wonderful. And one of the biggest challenges as we were getting close to the deadline for the book, and the deadline for the restoration to finish, and the Pope's visit was getting closer. I was going to the cathedral and talking to the workers and saying, like, so are you going to finish this section soon? Because I really need a picture of it so I can send it, you know. So that was incredible. Pretty daunting. But they were very aware of that and very proud. They're very proud of this book, too.
Sure. So.
And there's a pullout in the back for Pope Francis's visit,
yes,
right?
So yes.
That was kind of the last to be added.
That was the last to be added, yes.
It occurred just as the book was probably going to press, right? Pretty
right.
much.
Right, yeah. So he left, and then a day later, I was back with the layout designer of the book, and we were just madly putting it all together. And everyone was exhausted, of course, but sure. I was like, no, I need approval on this.
And,
you know,
so. And it doesn't look rushed or hurried. It's so beautifully yeah. laid out. It's
and,
gorgeous.
You know, it's very unique, honestly. And I mean, people at home, you should know this too. Like, there's all of these various things.
It.
And I really mean it. Like, this is like the real deal reproduction of, you know, what was given out for, you know, a Blessed Mother holiday right here that we were celebrating. And all of these different things. You're part of the history of the cathedral. You're in the archives with this book, which is
so clever,
very, very
and unique.
Rare. Like, this is just a great idea, you know?
Yeah.
And the stuff doesn't fall out. Like, it stays there. And it's a beautiful gift. So that to me is an amazing part of it. The other thing that's amazing, actually, and you should talk about this, is this picture.
Yeah.
Because... like any of us who've been to the city and been to the cathedral many, many times, you look at this and you say, I don't know how they got this
picture.
How did
you get that picture?
It's incredible.
Well, it's a composite of about 52 images.
Wow.
Whitney Cox, who's the photographer, had to stand on a ladder. We had to get approval from Rockefeller Center to put the ladder there. We had to get the right time of day. And he took all these images and stitched them together. He also had to take them in a way so that when we put it on the cover of the book, it wouldn't be, you know, stretched or anything like that. Because we actually had an image similar to it, but it wasn't the right dimensions. So we had to do it all over again.
Because those of you who are watching other parts of the country, across the street from St. Patrick's Cathedral is a very large statue of Atlas.
Yeah.
So even when you're looking out the door, the back door of St. Patrick's, there's this big statue of Atlas.
Right.
Who would be in your way if you wanted to take that picture?
That's exactly right.
And I said to myself, well, I don't think they moved that statue to do that.
That's really cool.
And then also, behind St. Patrick's Cathedral, bright blue sky, which is also a physical impossibility at this point with the building. Right? So it's a beautiful shot. I mean, it just, you know, I like the line, I guess you heard this, Kate, you know, when the Holy Father came, what he said to Cardinal Dolan.
Yes.
It's right in the middle of everything.
Yes, and that was an amazing moment. I was on the street when he got out, and his face, you could just see he was, like, totally taken aback. And the construction workers and restoration workers were to right on the other side, and there was a big group of them, and Cardinal Dolan pointed to them and said, you know, they did all this work, and they were blown away. And the Pope was blown away by the cathedral. And so it was a really, for me, it was a great moment. I know for everyone who worked on this project.
I mean, that's such a cool story. You must have a million awesome stories about your research and the people that you interviewed. Any standouts in your mind or your favorites?
Well, as I said, I loved being at the archives. Mm-hmm. And there were so many pieces and pictures and stories that it was hard to narrow it down.
Sure.
But each of those pullouts we did go through by hand and pick the paper so it would feel the same exact way that it felt in real life. I wrote one of the chapters, actually, and it was about, it's called Secrets of the Attic. And so that was fascinating because when I was up there, you know, I think people can feel... they feel like St. Patrick's is an oasis in the middle of a big city, which it is, but it can also feel kind of busy on the inside, too. During Mass, it can be a little bit distracting, depending on what's going on or the time of day. And when you go up to the towers, which is not open to the public, you felt even more peaceful. And it was like you kind of had this little, I don't know, insight into... the history of the cathedral, and you'd see names of people throughout the bell towers. Now, the names that are up there are firefighter inspectors and people who were doing, like, training runs, and then an occasional seminarian. And an occasional, I'm not sure how you got up here, but the names go back into the 1870s.
Really?
So the towers were finished in 1888, so I guess maybe... 1880s, they would go, depending on where you were in the tower.
Isn't that amazing? Yeah.
That's really interesting.
So that was very fun. And then the chapter, again, I also focused on four firefighter names were men who had been up there for some kind of training exercise before September 11th and who ended up dying on September 11th. So we kept those names and we covered them in like a glass scene so they won't dissipate over time.
Wow.
And so that's our little memorial to
them up there as well.
Yeah.
Now their names, like they actually wrote their names, or
they wrote their initials and their ladder number.
That's really cool. The pictures
are in the book too of that
as well. That's cool.
I love that.
And I think this is a no-brainer, but I mean, obviously, St. Patrick's Cathedral means a lot to you personally, right?
Yes, yes.
I mean, I know for myself, like doing the broadcasting from there a lot, you know, for Holy Week and stuff, I love just being enveloped by the place, you know, and I just love the presence of God in that place in the many different faces that come through there.
Yes.
It's amazing. It's still a place that has tremendous respect, I think, in the midst of the city, and has tremendous, like, kind of mystical... Yes, would you say?
I agree, absolutely. My dad's name is Patrick, so I have that attachment. But also, he and my mom are both converts to Catholicism.
Wow.
And he didn't know his dad very well growing up, and they met in New York City, actually, after many, many years, and when he was a young man after becoming Catholic. And he mentioned how he had gone to St. Patrick's when he first came into the city. And so I love to think of my dad, you know, as a young man and that big moment in his life, too.
That's so beautiful.
And there really is that sense of respect. We were just there during Easter week with my family, just walking in the city, and we stopped by. And I watched there were families and tour groups, and the security guards there are wonderful, so kind. And they had talked to a couple of teenagers and said, you have to take off your hats. And the respect that the teenagers had, okay. And the fact that they still do things like that in the middle of the city is really, really awesome.
A word about that, too, like the cathedral staff itself. The people who are there are really just beautiful people. Yeah, I mean, they're so helpful and kind. Yeah. The cathedral doesn't have a restroom. So this is one of the problems,
and,
you know, with so many people who visit. But yet, when you go there, they're so grateful. They'll get you one. They'll find you one.
That's right.
And like, there's two flights of stairs down to the left.
Yeah.
They'll get you there if you have to get there. If it's a very important trip, they make
sure. That's right.
That's part of what makes this, I think, all this to say, America's parish church.
Yes, absolutely.
Because all truly are welcome there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Homeless people who are sleeping,
yes.
Millionaires who are taking a break from their big meetings, you'll see them all there at the same time, really, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And you see frequent faces, too. Like, after, you know, first when I got there, I was kind of, it's like, oh, there's a lot of people, you don't recognize them. And then over time, you see different, you know, sometimes they're people who might be a little more on the troubled side, but they clearly find peace at St. Patrick's,
yeah.
And that's really... And everyone knows them. Like, I'll notice them and different priestly staff, and they'll be like, oh, have you seen the guy who sits in that pew who sings really loud?
Really?
I want to make sure he's okay, because they'll be, like, kind of looking out for them. But then you also see, very people dressed to the nines and in there for lunch break or, you know, all kinds of things. And they clearly feel at home at St. Patrick's and love it. And some of the people who wrote entries about being married at St. Patrick's, in the book, they were just so thrilled and remembered. I asked them to remember, like, the day their child was baptized or the day they were married, and they remembered it perfectly. And so much of it, obviously, those are personally significant events, regardless of where you are.
Sure.
But it seemed that St. Patrick's, it was particularly moving for them to recount, you know, the doors opening and how beautiful it was and how important it was to them.
That's great.
The place is so filled with history, and that was going to be my advice to all of you. Probably you've been, or if you haven't and you're going to visit, go to St. Patrick's Cathedral. There's no other place you want to visit when you're in Manhattan. That's the place you go. It's the first place to go. And if you were going to get one thing to commemorate that visit, this was what you would get.
Oh,
I mean, honestly, because it tells the story, but it's also beautifully depicted. You don't have to take one photograph while you're there, because they're all here. And you have the close-up shots you're never going to be able to get with your iPhone, trust me. And it's just such a beautiful, beautiful book. I really cherish it, Kate. Thanks so much for doing what you did. Now, if people want to get it.
That's what I was going to say. Where can people get it?
So they can go to the gift shop inside the cathedral or the gift shop across the street from the cathedral on 51st Street. Mm-hmm. They can also buy it online at stpatrickscathedral.org.
Okay, St. Patrick's Cathedral. And then is there one spcbook.org,
yes,
too?
Yes, and spcbook.org.
You can
go
get it there, too.
Well.
So this is a book that, again, is near and dear to the heart of Cardinal Dolan, but near and dear to all of us who find St. Patrick's Cathedral, you know, a piece of our heart, a piece of our lives, a piece of our spiritual life. So thanks so much for doing this.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
This is one cool book.
We
do a lot of books, but this is one cool one, I have to say. Right?
Yeah,
really, a nice job. Thanks so much for doing this. This was great. All right, we're going to take a quick break. We've got lots more to go with good news, so stick around.
Welcome back, everyone.
On Friday, March 18th, Bishop William Murphy rededicated St. Agnes Cathedral in Rockville Center, New York, after its several year-long renovation, and consecrated the altar in a special celebration. Reopening means the return of masses, funerals, weddings, baptisms, and communions in our beloved cathedral parish. Meanwhile, work will continue on the church's front exterior, and I took a trip to St. Agnes to see what's been done so far and what's to come. Here now is my report. I'm here with Monsignor Bill Koenig to talk about the renovations that have been going on at the cathedral here at St. Agnes. Thank you so much for being with us, Monsignor.
It's great to be here.
Can you talk to us a little bit about these renovations, what's been done lately?
Sure. We've had a 2-year program. The first year was in the winter of 2015, and at that time we did the work in the back part of the sanctuary, which is behind us. We had a baldachin installed that would be able to frame and enthrone the tabernacle. The tabernacle was brought from one of the side chapels into the main body of the church. And on that baldachin, there are various saints. There's 10 saints that we incorporated into that baldachin. And that was really the first part of the renovation. That took about 3 months in 2015. And then 2016, the day after the weekend of New Year's, we closed the cathedral once again, and we had no masses here at all. All the masses were in the parish center or in the Laurel Hall. And we did the rest of the church, which meant as far as the sanctuary area, we continued the marble flooring, and we had a mosaic installed on the marble around the altar. We had a new altar installed, as well as the ambo, sometimes referred to as the pulpit, and we also had a new baptismal font. And the way we placed this, we had in different parts of the cathedral. Formerly, the ambo and the baptismal font were on one side. In the renovation, we moved the ambo to the right side as you face the sanctuary, and the baptismal font on the left side and the altar in the middle. So it really gives a great balance. And then the rest of the cathedral we had painted. We also painted the ceiling. The ceiling, you might remember, was what was affectionately called by our parishioners the Rubik's Cube. And it was a very colorful painting of the ceiling. And instead, we toned that down and made it more of a neutral color. We painted the walls. We had the pews all removed, and they were brought back in, and they were redone, refinished. New kneelers were placed in the beneath the pews. Beneath the pews was also carpeting that had been there for about 35 years, so they had seen their share of Cheerios and things like that.
Yeah.
And they really, it was really kind of worn and torn in some places. And so we had the carpeting removed, and we had tile put beneath the pews.
Now, how is the reception when the people were allowed to come back to the cathedral?
It was really spectacular. I mean, the people, because they weren't seeing it gradually take place, because it was closed the entire time, they walked in, and they were just overwhelmed by the really the beauty of the, especially the sanctuary. And so they've been very, very appreciative. And so many of the parishioners have supported the project in many great ways, through prayer, through their own sacrifices as far as their monetary gifts, as well as people in our diocese beyond our cathedral parish have also supported it.
Now, Monsignor, can you talk about the importance of this cathedral to the diocese and to people really all around who come to visit the cathedral? Why is it such an important and special place?
Sure. This is the cathedral because it's the seat of the bishop, and literally his seat is here. The cathedra that's in the church was installed back in 2015, and it was a chair that was used by Bishop Kellenberg.
Ah.
Chair means in Latin, the word for chair in Latin is cathedra. And so this is where the bishop's chair is.
Oh,
and so
wow.
In 1957, when the Diocese of Rockville Center was formed by the Pope, this was the church that was selected as the bishop's church.
Okay.
And therefore it became no longer just St. Agnes Cathedral Church, but now St. Agnes Cathedral.
Oh, that's beautiful. I noticed when I was walking in that there was still some construction going on. So is there still more work to be done?
Yes. Interior, we're fine. We still have some more lighting to install, but that's not going to be at all invasive. That's done from above. But the exterior, there's been quite a bit of work that's been going on for the last 10 months or so, where we've been working on the front of the building. There's scaffolding mm-hmm. out there. That's been replacing limestone caps, the flashing. It's been pointing the concrete between the bricks. It's been replacing certain bricks. That hopefully will be finished in the summertime. Brides are anxiously waiting
sure.
when exactly that's going to take place. But right now it's a little bit nebulous as far as when exactly. And then after that, we have to really decide about the other three sides of the cathedral, which fortunately are not quite as extensive as that front. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, our engineering report tells us that that has to be done also. It'll be a matter of just saying, is this the time to do it, or should we wait several years and take care of that?
So how many years from the beginning until the projected end will this project have taken place?
Well, as far as the ideas and the concept goes, that was existing before I got here, which I got here in the year 2009. So over 7 years ago, they had been talking about the interior. There were artist drawings for it. But I think over the last 3 years, that's when we've really kind of gone ahead with reaching out to parishioners, mm-hmm. asking for their support, and then actually carrying out the renovation.
Well, it looks spectacular, as you say. Such a special place, and I know so many of our viewers who watch the daily mass or the Sunday mass here, they really rely on this cathedral, this very special church. So thank you so much for being with
You're
us,
welcome.
Monsignor.
Great to be here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow, they really did a beautiful job. That was
they absolutely
incredible
did.
To see up close like that, you know?
It really is. And getting to know the cathedral in intimate ways is really very cool. It's a beautiful, beautiful cathedral.
I remember the last renovation because I was ordained like right after the last
oh,
renovation.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I mean, you know, and it was a big deal then, but this is just so gorgeous.
It really
As
is.
I said to the bishop, 30 to 40 years, we're set now. So that's
Oh, good.
I think it's a great gift, really.
Sounds
beautiful
good.
Gift.
It is. It's absolutely beautiful.
Good job.
Thanks.
It was fun, too,
It was
right?
fun. Something
yeah.
different. I like getting out on the road.
Yeah, you like being out. That's a good thing. I'll stay here, thanks. Speaking of staying here, we have to take a quick break, but stick around because we have lots more good news right after this. Welcome back, everyone. Well, that was fun, wasn't it?
Oh, it was so great.
And
I
you
learned
got to
a lot.
Go out and do a little road work?
I love it.
That's
I
great.
Really
no
do.
Hard hat for you this time. I remember you being, were you in the cathedral with a hard hat at one point?
I wish, but no.
No
I have been
yes.
in the cathedral, and it's been incredible. I
yeah.
love to do things like that.
Yeah, it's beautiful. It's fun stuff,
it
right?
It is, yeah.
You know, for all of us, like, these places mean an awful lot to us. I remember being a little boy, a very little boy, and going to the city with my parents or with my grandfather, and my great-grandmother giving me a quarter and say, Jamezilla, light a candle at St. Patrick's Cathedral for me. And when I go to St. Patrick's Cathedral to this very day, I still light a candle for my great-grandmother. There's something kind of important, these churches that we're tied to in our lives. I was fortunate enough one time to be in a church in Astoria, Queens, Precious Blood. It was the church that I was baptized in. Though I didn't know that, I called home just to see how things were going on my kind of journey there as I was parking the car. And my mom said to me, don't forget you were baptized there. And to be able to bless myself with holy water from that font where I began my journey, it was really a beautiful thing. Our churches mean a lot to us. The places where we pray, the places where we gather with our community, with our family, in good times and in bad, in sickness and in health, they mean a lot to us. The church is an important place. A lot of people say, oh, I could pray on my own. You can, but there's nothing quite like praying in the context of the church. There's nothing quite like the community coming together or even taking a trip in alone sometimes and praying in the context of that church. I love to pray at St. Patrick's Cathedral, St. Agnes Cathedral, and the many different churches in my own life that have meant a lot to me. Hopefully you have that same experience. If you're stuck at home and cannot get out, we bring the church to you every day. And that's part of the important link that we have here with you, that we want to bring you St. Agnes and St. Patrick's Cathedral and other churches where you can pray and be a part of it, because the building is not just a building. It's a place where our spirits kind of dwell and all the lives of those who've gone before us dwell, which is important too, right?
Yes. I love that our churches can be all different shapes and sizes. And like you said, even sometimes on TV, it's still mass, it's still church. So.
Yeah. There's something still beautiful about that. So I think that's part of the beauty of what we took a look at today.
That's
You know, it makes me want to go back to these cathedrals and take another look.
I know. Oh, absolutely. Now that you know the little story, definitely.
Next time I'm in Rockville Center or in St. Patrick's in the city, I'm going to take a deeper look.
Now, what did your great-grandma call you?
Jamaziel.
Really?
Yeah, that's the Italian James.
Jamaziel.
My whole family calls me James, so Jamaziel.
I love it.
It gave me a quarter, and a quarter was a lot of money back
then
in the day. And she said, go light a candle for me. I just lit one for a couple of weeks ago at St. Patrick's Cathedral.
Beautiful.
So I hope she's rejoicing in heaven, too.
Aww,
it's a good thing.
It's a great story.
So good show today. I hope you enjoyed it. Remember, whatever you do this week,
keep on spreading the good news.
See you soon, everybody. God bless.
Everyone.